Hello and welcome to the course CS348 Advanced Computer Network. In this lecture, we are going to discuss about fast retransmit and fast recovery. This represents the syllabus of our course, and we have already discussed about congestion control and slow start. The today's lecture is on fast retransmit or fast recovery process. So before I explain fast retransmit and fast recovery, let us first understand when we are sending the data from host A to host B. Let's say these are two computers who want to communicate. Then first of all, they have to establish the connection. If TCP is concerned, whenever a TCP connection made, then they are sending the data in three phase, means the entire data transfer constitute of three phase. One phase is called connection establishment. After the connection establishment is done, the actual data get transferred, and finally the connection will be terminated. Okay, the connection establishment is a three-way handshaking process where the sender or the host A who want to communicate with host B send a request message to establish a connection. Then host B sends a confirmation message, and finally host A acknowledges that confirmation and the connection is get established. After that, the actual data transmission starts, and finally after the data transmission is over, the connection termination process will be carried out in the same manner as connection establishment. Only the thing is some flag bits has been changed in the packet from host A to host B to terminate the connection, but the same three-way handshaking process will be carried out. Okay, another thing we want to know is whenever the connection establishment, why the connection establishment is done? Because we know that the TCP is a connection oriented protocol, so the connection has to be established fast before the data get transmitted. Another thing, for flow control, error control and congestion control, connection establishment is needed. Why needed, I don't want to explain here because this is the part of your normal networking course. You might have already studied all these things in your networking classes itself. So but for understanding fast retransmit and fast recovery, whatever needed, I'm just explaining over here. Okay, so now let us understand what is a sequence number, acknowledgement number and timeout. So what is a sequence number? Suppose host A and host B want to communicate with each other. We know that TCP is a provides full duplex mode of communication. So when host A, let's say host A want to send a file of size 10,000 byte, then during the connection establishment, they will agree upon a maximum segment size, MSS. So the maximum segment size will be agreed upon whenever the connection is established. Okay, and when the connection after the connection establishment, the host A will divide the 1000 byte, the file, into number of segments. Okay, as decided, it was, let's say for this example, let's say the maximum segment size will be 1000 byte, then he has to divide the entire file into 1000 byte each with numbering from 0 to 999. This is first byte will be represented by 0, second byte is represented by 1, and so on. So this is 1000 byte, this is one segment. Okay, similarly this is another segment, and so on. Then we have to, after dividing the segment, we have to give the sequence number. Let's say we give the second sequence number to this byte as 0, but actually the sequence number may not be 0, it can be any random number. Like in the next line, we have chosen a random number as 53 with the sequence number for this. So if this is the sequence number for the entire segment, then how many bytes we are going to transfer? 1000 byte. So the next sequence number must be 1000 for general case, but for actual case, it is 1000 byte. After transferring at 1000 byte, the next segment sequence number may be 1053, because 53 to 1052 will be one segment. Then 1053 to 2052 will be another segment. In this manner, we will divide the segment, and these are the sequence numbers. Okay. Now the next part we want to discuss is acknowledgement number. This is slightly trickier than sequence number. Let us understand it. Let the sequence number, let host A want to contact with host B. Okay. Generally, sequence number is nothing but it is the expected sequence number of the next byte. I am talking about acknowledgement number. So the acknowledgement number is nothing but it is the expected sequence number of the next byte. Means, suppose two parties connecting, A and B. Suppose A sends a data with sequence number 1, then host B will acknowledge it by 2, because he is expecting that next byte will be 2. 1 has been received properly. To show that, I am using this figure. Let's say host A sends a data with sequence number 35. He has decided that the sequence number I'll use is 35. By using that sequence number, he sent 1 byte of information. Okay, now just now, for the time being, just forget about this acknowledgement. I'll explain later on. So let's say host A sends a sequence number 35 with 1 byte of data. On receiving 35, host B will not reply with that I have received 35. Actually, what host B will reply? He will reply with ACK36. What does it mean? It means that I have received the 35 properly. Now you can send the sequence number 36. Got it? After receiving this, the host A again send the next 1 byte, which is 36. Similarly, what he will reply? He will reply like this. Suppose when he will reply, what he will reply with in the acknowledgement field? He will reply acknowledgement 37. Why so? Because he has already received 36 in a proper format. But let's say if the 36 is lost in the transit, then he has to resend that, no, I have not get the 36 properly, so he will send ACK36 again. That means somewhere the 36 sequence number packet has been lost. Okay, this is how the acknowledgement numbers has been given. Then what is the meaning of this acknowledgement number? So that acknowledgement number is ACK1073. This may be acknowledging host B that I have received. Means host A, means it is represented in the previous communication. Host A is trying to say to the host B that I have already received the data up to 1073. Now you can say, 1072. Now you can send 1073. So if you see in the reply message, he has acknowledged the receipt of 35, as well as he has given the sequence number 1073, which was acknowledged by host A. So that is the meaning of 1073 over here. So when host A receives sequence number 173 in a proper format, then he will reply with acknowledgement 1074. That means host A is trying to tell host B that I have received sequence number 1073 properly. Now you can send 1074. Okay. That is how the acknowledgement number is defined. The next one is called timeout period. So how the timeout period is established? During the connection, there will be a RTT will be defined. RTT means your round trip time, that the time from when a segment is sent until it is acknowledged. Okay, like from here to here, he has sent the packet and acknowledged at here. So this will be treated as your RTT. This was been calculated during the connection establishment itself. Okay, then according to the RTT, a timeout period will be set. So what is a timeout period? Timeout period should be larger than the connection's RTT. Why? Because he is expecting that the data is takes this much of time to send and we receive the acknowledgement. So if I take a round trip time up to the maximum of RTT, then probably I will get the packet after sending it. Probably I get the acknowledgement after sending at particular amount of time. So that's why the timeout period is set. If the receiver does not receive the packet in the timeout period, then he has to resend the packet again. Okay, this is all about your timeout. So you got the knowledge of sequence number, acknowledgement number and timeout. These are the most needed thing to understand fast retransmit. So let us first explain the fast retransmit in a proper manner. Then I'll give you an example to understand the entire process. So as I have already discussed that whenever let's say A sends a packet with sequence number 35, let us say, okay, and B received that, he has set a timer for let's say T1 time. Between T1 time, the acknowledgement must come. Let's say B has due to some reason, B is not able to send the acknowledgement. Okay, if he is not get that, if A does not get the acknowledgement in time, then he has to resend the packet again after the timeout period is over. Okay, why it is happening? This is due to the timeout triggered retransmission process. So what is the problem here? The problem with timed out triggered retransmission, this is called the timed out triggered retransmission. Means when the timeout is over, we have to retransmit the data. If I get the acknowledgement between the timeout, then we need to send the new data. That is called the timeout triggered retransmission. Fine. So what is the problem with that? The problem is the timeout period may be relatively long. It may be long. Yes. When a segment is lost, this long timeout period forces the sender to delay resending the lost packet. Okay, assume that during the timeout period, let's say he sends a packet 32 and it get lost here. Let's say he send a packet and it lost here. It has not reached to B. And somehow in between the timeout period, he able to know that the packet has already been lost. How he know that, I will explain just now. For the timing, assume that node A has sent a packet with sequence number 35 and it get lost and it is not reached to B. He has already set the timer, but he immediately knows that after the sending, he knows that the packet has been lost. So he may immediately send the packet to B, but A do not do that. A has to wait for T1 time, means the completion of your timeout period, to send the packet. So that is the disadvantage of timeout triggered retransmission. By doing that, what will happen? It increases the end-to-end delay. Okay, that's why that is the disadvantage of timed out triggered retransmission. Fine. So now next question is, how could the sender will know that the packet has already been lost? So it will be lost, it will be understood by the help of duplicate acknowledgement. So what do you mean by duplicate acknowledgement? The meaning of duplicate acknowledgement is re-acknowledging a segment. Means let me take you an example. Okay, suppose let's say A has sent sequence number 35. A has sent a packet with sequence number 35. He received it. Okay, then he reply a message that I have received 35, so send the 36. Then let's say he sent another packet with 36, but due to some reason 36 get lost. Then he sent another packet 37, but 37 gets reached. Okay, let's say this is 37 get reached, this is 36. Okay, now when 37 get reached, B is expecting that 36 should reach, but he is getting 37. Then what he will do? In the previous, like previous, this is the actual acknowledgement. Means he expecting 36, but he is getting 37. Why? Because 36 is already lost in the transit. That's why for this particular communication, he will reply with 36 again. So this is your duplicate acknowledgement. Okay, because it has already been acknowledged that he has received 35, now you send 36. but the sender sends 37 and 37 is reached because 36 is already lost. So that's why the duplicate alert in 36 is generated. Got my point? So due to this, the sender will know that the packet get lost. Means suppose assume that the timer has been set up to this, then he could have encountered the loss of 36. Fine. So before time he is able to know this. So if before time he is able to know it, then why should he will wait for the timer to stop to send 36 the 36th packet? Got my point? This is the main purpose of fast retransmit. So this thing happen. Why it is happen? Because be expecting 35, then 36, then 37, then 38, and so on. But remember, if some reorder is done, that means something wrong over here. So suppose that he received 35, then he received 37 as per this particular case. That means something wrong in the network itself. Okay. So that thing I have written over here. When a TCP receiver receives a segment with a sequence number that is larger than the next expected, like B expecting 36, but he is getting 37, which is larger than the expected in order of sequence number, it detects a gap in the data stream. So obviously that will be a gap. That is a missing segment. That means a segment has already been missed. That is 36. This gap could be a result of lost or reordered segment within the network. So either it will be lost or something has been reordered in the network itself. But for reliable delivery, the TCP has to send the acknowledgement that I need 36 immediately to make it reliable. So that's why what the B will do, as I have already done duplicate acknowledgement, it simply duplicate acknowledgement, the last in order byte of the data it has received. So that part I have already discussed here. Now let us understand the next process. So a sender often sends a large number of segments back to back. Generally what happens, the sender, as you remember in the slow start process, the sender is continuously sending the packets. Okay, let's say in this particular case, the sender is sending the packets continuously, like 35, then 36, then 37, then 38, and so on. Okay, the window size is increased. In the first term, he sent one packet, then in the second term, he sent two packets, in the third term, he sent four packets, if you remember the slow start method. So it will continuously send the packets. If one segment is lost, there will be likely be many back-to-back duplicate acknowledgement. Why? Because see, suppose first segment is reached properly and it has been acknowledged, let's say 36. But let's say 36 get lost here. Then after he gets 37, for this 37, even if 37 is reached here, he expecting 36, but 36 get lost. So he will send an acknowledgement 36 again for this received, means for when he received 38, again he has to reply with 36 because 36 yet not received, and he is getting the packets above 36, that is 37, 38, 39. So these are what? These are duplicate acknowledgements. These are duplicate acknowledgements, right? So if one segment is lost, there will be likely to many back-to-back duplicate acknowledgement. So if the TCP sender receives three duplicate acknowledgement, that is the rule for fast retransmit, if it gets three duplicate acknowledgement for the same data, it takes this as an indication that the segment following the segment that has been acknowledged three times has been lost. So that means if he gets three times the duplicate acknowledgement, not the original one, this is the original acknowledgement, when he gets three duplicate like this, 36, 36, 36, then the sender understood that 36 has already been lost in the network. So that means we have to retransmit without waiting for the timer to finish. That is called fast retransmission. So in the case that three duplicate acknowledgement has received, the TCP sender performs a fast retransmit. So retransmitting the missing segment before that segment's timer expires. So before the timer of this 36 expire, he has to retransmit the segment. That is called the concept of fast retransmit. Right? I hope you understand the concept. Now let us take the example to clearly understood this concept. So the example is slightly animated. It will look good and it will be understandable properly. Let us say these are the two hosts, host A and host B, want to communicate with each other. Now host A sends the packets continuously. As I have already discussed, it will continuously send the packets. Okay, like sequence number 35, the data size is 100,000 bytes. Forget about the acknowledgement field over here. Only one way communication, you think. Okay, means one way means the sender only sends and receiver only sends acknowledgement. So he has sent how many packet? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Everything is 1000 byte. I have not written 1000 here for the drawing to be look clear. That's why I have not written here. So there will be data equal to 1000 byte is here only. So he has sent 35, then sent the sequence number 1035 because this contains 1000 byte. Then this is the sequence number 1035. This contains 1000 bytes, so this the sequence number will be 2035, 3035, 4035, and so on. Okay, he is continuously sending, and the timeout period is something like this. He has set the timeout period for the first one. Okay, now assume that the first one is received properly, the third one, fourth one, fifth one is received properly, but the second one, which with sequence number 1035, get lost and it is not reached to host B. Then what will happen? So after receiving the first one, he has replied the acknowledgement, that is acknowledgement 1035. He has received the sequence number 35 properly of 1000 bytes. So what he expecting? He is expecting 1035 in the next part. Means if this particular byte would be reached, then that is okay. But for our case, this is lost already. So what will happen? Before the timeout period over, see what happened. So when he receives the acknowledgement, he again sets a timeout period for the first one. Then what happened? If you see, for other received packets, like for 2035, 3035, 4035, he is receiving it sequentially, but he is expecting 1035. So, and he is not getting it because it has already been lost. So for every received, he is sending a duplicate acknowledgement. This is the first duplicate acknowledgement, this is the second duplicate acknowledgement, this is the third duplicate acknowledgement. So these are received by the host B. So when the host saw that, host A saw that three duplicate acknowledgement, this is the original acknowledgement, this is the duplicate acknowledgement, then immediately before the timeout has been finished here. So he could have sent the 1035 after this, but he has to send it before the timeout period. So he will send the sequence number 1035 data 1000 byte. Forget about that acknowledgement. So this is resending packet. So what do you mean by this resending packet? That is called fast retransmit. So I hope you understand the concept of fast retransmit. Now let us understand the fast recovery process. So what will happen in the fast recovery process? I will again explain all the steps, then I will take an example. You will be easily understood this point. Okay, first of all, what happened when we will reach to fast recovery process? When three duplicate acknowledgement are detected, TCP performs fast retransmit, as we have discussed here. TCP immediately perform retransmit process when three duplicate acknowledgement transport. Now after three back-to-back duplicate acknowledgement, generally what happen, the TCP slower down the sending process. If you see here, he is continuously sending the data. When he gets three acknowledgement, he immediately come to the sending, means he immediately reduce the congestion window to one. Okay, then he sends one packet, then again the slow start process will be going on, if you remember in the last class. So TCP performs fast retransmit and enter the fast recovery state. Okay, so when he fast retransmit, then he try to recover from it because it is already slowed down, so he has to recover it. Though generally fast recovery is not required, but it is recommended. So some TCP recommend that you should use the concept of fast recovery. But when actually what happened? Actually, whenever you get three duplicate acknowledgement, the TCP start the fast retransmission, then he goes into the slow start mode. So that I have written here, over here. It says that without going to the slow start mode, so what does the fast recovery says? Fast recovery says, without going to the slow start mode after receiving three acknowledgement packet, TCP can enter fast recovery mode for better performance. Okay, So when what happened in slow start mode? In slow start mode, the segment size is reduced to 1. Then he sent 1. Then after next turn, he will send 2. Then in that third turn, he sent 4, and so on. So fast recovery says that without going to the slow start mode, why don't you come to fast recovery mode? Because that will be the congestion is not there in the transmission, because here there is no congestion, only one packet get lost. So you can go for the, for better performance, you can go for faster recovery. So what happened in faster, in slow start mode, what happened? In the slow start mode, the congestion window automatically set to 1 MSS, that is the maximum sample size, and grows exponentially. But in fast recovery mode, what happened? But in fast recovery mode, the congestion window reduced by half and grows linearly. So it will be reduced by half. It is not reduced by 1 MSS. Okay, hence the performance is better than slow start. Okay, so let us understand it. There are two different versions of TCP. One is called TCP Tahoe and another is TCP Reno. So TCP Tahoe actually jumps to slow start when 3 duplicate acknowledgement is received. But the newer version of TCP is TCP Reno, which is actually incorporate the fast recovery. Right, let us understand it properly. See what happened. Let's say this is the graph where I am showing these are the transmission round and this is showing the number of segment or the congestion window in segments. Initially what will happen, let's say this is the threshold, as we have already discussed this part in the fast slow start also, so it will be repeated and you will be able to understand this one very quickly, because if you have read that previous lecture, it will be very much easier to understand. So let us understand it. So what happened? It will be started in a slow start manner. Let's say this is your one. This is one. Okay. One. So the window size initially get one and the fast data get transmitted. If the acknowledgement is received, then the window size becomes two. Okay. Then the two segment of data has been sent. Okay. Then after sending the two segment, if the acknowledgement is received in the third transmission round, then the segment size or the congestion window size is increased to 4 segment. Okay, then in the transmission round 4th, the congestion window size will be increased to 8. Now we have reached two threshold, means there will be a threshold defined by your TCP connection protocol. So the threshold here is 8. So we have already increased the congestion window size to 8. Then after what happened, this is the slow start method. Then after the congestion window increases by 1 only. So you can see this is 1. So that is 9. 9 number of segment can be sent. Then 10, then 11, 10, then 11, then 12. So 12 number of packet has been sent. This is the slow start method. Now assume that at this particular point, after the window size or the congestion window size becomes 12 segment, then a 3 acknowledgement concept occur here, means somewhere one packet gets lost. So if this is done, then what will happen? The threshold immediately reduced to the half. That is the now it is 12, already up to 12 the communication is going fine. So it is immediately reduced to half, that is 6. Then the TCP enters the slow start mode again, means it will start from 1 again. Okay, then he'll send one packet. If he gets the acknowledgement, then he again get two packets, that is 4. So one packet and two packet, then the threshold value, that is 6, so up to 6. Then he will increase by 1, 1, 1, 1. So this is 1, 6 to 7, this is 8, this is 9. In this manner it will going on. So what this method is, this is called TCP Tahoe. This version of TCP uses the slow start method. But what happened in TCP Reno? It goes on the recovery process, means that is the fast recovery process. So when the 3 acknowledgement process get means involved, when the 3 acknowledgement hit get, then immediately what will happen? It will reduce the segment size to 6, not 1. Okay, then he will grow linearly, but it grow exponentially. But this one grows linearly, 1 by 1, like from 6 window to 7, 7 to 8, 8 to 9, and so on. and this is what? This is actually TCP Reno. So that's all about your fast recovery process. I hope you understood the concept. Thank you for listening.